Myself Bhushan Mahajan, and the title of my study is Implementation of Synchronous Time Dissemination Voice and Video Relay Protocol in Wireless Sensor Network. As the name indicates, it's a wireless sensor network and it's a time disseminated, that means TDMA, time lapse. So my guide, Dr. Professor A.R. Mahajan, and she belongs to IT department, Government Polytechnic, Nagpur. In this pre-submission seminar, I have covered my research objectives, motivations, then wireless sensor networks take apart, research gaps, design consideration, and my proposed protocol, STVVP, and simulation and the results. The research objective highlight, I have highlighted that in wireless sensor network, my focus is in this case, time synchronization is a main focus here. Along with that, I am doing multimedia data transfer, that is some video and audio bits. So compression is required because uncompressed data is heavy to deliver. Then some bytes, transmission techniques, and there should be delay aware and traffic aware. Main focus is to avoid the congestion, to avoid the overhead of control packets, and retransmission should be as minimum as possible. My motivation is how to do parallel execution between the set of nodes within a cluster. A cluster which is having a cluster head as an entity where all the cluster member nodes submit their result. Then hidden terminal problem which is to be avoided. We are adding nodes capabilities. We are adding node memory. We are adding node processing power so that additive or summation of processing can be achieved so that the task should get completed with minimum time because of parallel processing. Non-conflicting schedule, I mean the time slots have to be designed. So this is the main aim, that how do you design the time slots and how do you design the time slots so that no overlapping but parallel processing should be achieved. So here clock synchronization is important because we are concentrating on distributed architecture where nodes are in synchronization but they are distributed way. There is no central coordinator. The asterisk mark things, these are actually the features of wireless sensor network, but the asterisks which I have marked, my primary focus area is cooperative task processing, then parallel node scheduling, decentralized schedule, with the need of, there should not be any need of carrier sensing, which we usually see in MAC protocol, where we sense the carrier medium first, channel. Then backup node for processing. This is general way how wireless sensor network work, where you have a sink, some cluster is there.
To come down to your main part of unless of wasting time in
should I talk about the related study or
is what is important as far as your presentation?
A bit of related study is fine, but consider it more upon your work so that we can see and
okay, sir. So these are the research gaps which I have identified after going through the research works by the previous authors. They design the slots I mean the papers which I have referred, they designed the slots based on various criteria like how the load balancing is to be done, or how the number of nodes we have in our network. Based on that, they designed the time slots. Where I have designed time slots for the path, and path is treated as an entity, because one path contains say 5, 10 or 50 nodes. Each node has some capacity remaining, some consumption he has already consumed, some energy has already consumed in working. Now some amount of energy is remaining. So how much capacity of each node is balanced, and to what extent I can take out the working from node. So I have treated a path as an entity, and based on path I design the path history, and based on the path history I design how many number of slots can be provided. Cluster head is there which manage the cluster members, and the simple funda is if I have a cluster and I have cluster members, I will divide the task. All the cluster members will cooperatively perform the task, submit the result to cluster head. Cluster head will forward the result to next cluster head. Similarly, 5 or 6 clusters in sequence parallelly process and complete the task. How many nodes you have? It's n nodes. So your work done will be in a shorter time divided by n. Let's say we require a time frame of say t, but you have now n number of processors with you, so your time will get reduced by t by n. And strategy should be such that the conflict should not be there. When one node transmit, other node should not transmit at the same time. He should be kept busy in working or in processing actually. So topology which I have considered, I have 3 kind of layers. The cluster head and cluster members, they work in a star topology fashion. When 2 adjacent cluster heads communicate, they are in bus topology, like one cluster head is passing its content to another cluster head. So there is a bus topology. And the coordinator, there is a square agent. Square agent means all 4 clusters are combined or controlled by one entity node, that is the square agent and the cluster head. So coordinator source, coordinator, square agent, and square agent control say 5 cluster heads. So this is the combination where again the star topology. Within time slot, when we say about time slot design, these things are considered: density of nodes, how many nodes you have. So more number of nodes, more scalability, more addition, more advantage, because we got more memory, we got more processing nodes, okay, and we are in a position to complete the given task of say compression, decompression, or any kind of operation which require more than one node. So it's advantage, not disadvantage. And we keep some active nodes as well as some backup nodes with us within the cluster, so that if one path get overused, okay, we shift the path and we shift the load to some other path, and we achieve the load balancing in that way. Path history is maintained, prediction of task is done, how it will complete the task, at what time it will complete the task, that prediction is done through the protocol. 3 kind of queries are used, where to know the path history, there is a path head node which maintains all the log, how many time this path is getting used, how many nodes, how many transmission rounds or how many transmission cycles each path have performed. So based on that, path history is built up, and based on the path history, next work, whether to assign that one or not, or to choose some other path, is decided. Then node info, to give the snapshot of how much transmission and receive cycles each node perform, and then task info queries. So this kind of queries we use. Path history, bytes per node, packet payload limit, packet to be delivered, these all factors need to consider while designing time slots for node. Cluster design include how to choose the cluster head or how to select the cluster head. There are a lot of protocols for selection of cluster head. Then how cluster members are selected, how to build the cluster database or path database, and how the distributed cluster information should be circulated. This is the normal topology. Here we have a coordinator. Here is a square agent, cluster 1, cluster 2, cluster 3, and here is a receiver. So there is a very minimum packet exchange, because when this cluster is activated, it distributes its tasks to all its cluster members. Cluster members start processing. When they process, they avoid transmission of message, they avoid receiving of message, and within the given transmission slot only they are allowed to transmit. Within the given receiving slot only they are allowed to receive. So in this way, when one is processing, other is, let's say, doing communication. So no parallel transmission or no parallel receiving is required. Here is the algorithm where we have a cluster head and it received the packet. It checked the packet ID, it checked whether it is for him or not. If it is for him, simply add the information of the cluster member, it adds the information of the root, and based on this data, some database is built up. That database is very essential for contributing for designing the route, for designing the path, and for designing how many time slots each node will take. Similarly, here is a node. He is a member of some cluster, so it receives the cluster packet. Check packet IDs. I have designed some custom packets. I have designed an agent in C++ in NS2 2.34, where I have designed custom packets and some logic. Based on the packet IDs, it decides what response should be given. So if packet ID is 2, that means it has received, node has received some packet from cluster head. It had info in routing member. Each packet contain cluster ID also and path ID also. Similarly, here are some flowcharts at the cluster head level, at the cluster member level. Check the cluster ID, whether a packet belongs to same cluster ID or not. If it is from the same cluster ID, then forward packet to its cluster head, or keep it up to itself, or do task as per said in the cluster packet. We have a task list there designed specially for which kind of task node has to perform. Here is a cluster ID match. They look through all the cluster member list for which this packet is cluster head decided. Otherwise, it will either forward it, or it will, if it is for itself, it will reply the packet. Now, how to set schedule for the cluster members? This is the most important part. Where coordinator sends some packet to square agent. Square agent is, it's a super cluster, or it's a cluster head of super cluster. So SA received the packet, check packet ID 3, I have given some packet ID 3 here to identify that this kind of packet is used for designing the time slots. So if packet ID is 3 and if its own entry is not existed, then append the entry in path. Next is, if packet ID is 3, own entry not found, append entry in slot variable. Then SA will design slots of transmission, slots of processing, and slots of receiving. These three kind of slots are essential for each cluster member node. Secondly, adjust clock, because as we have seen that in this slide, this is a distributed structure where this thing is not controlled from anywhere. This cluster, it is not controlled from anywhere. each should have a clock, global clock, local clock in synchronization, because this is not going to communicate with coordinator. This is going to pass its packet directly here. After processing the task using say 10 nodes, this packet will be directly passed to here. So each of them should be in sync. Their clocks should be in sync. Initiation will be done from here, but after that all clocks should get synced and output will flow from cluster 1 to cluster 2 to cluster 3 to receiver. There is no need to communicate or to intimate coordinator or square agent that I am doing this or I am doing that. Okay, cluster heads knows what they have to do. After accumulating data from these nodes, this is the camera node, these are the processing node where they are, let's say, doing wavelet transformation or JPEG wavelet transformation. After that compression, they forward it here, say relay, then it decompress here, or they combine, or they merge, and finally provide the video clip to receiver. So image capturing and then image conversion or image clip formation directly done through all the cluster heads. Algorithm to update the cluster heads whenever any cluster member die or whenever any cluster member have a energy level below the threshold, that cluster member is not used and some other cluster member or backup cluster member is used instead. So here it is noted that what the threshold is and how many times he has performed task and what amount of energy is left. Can it serve such the purpose? Can it stay in the path or should we bypass it and use some other optional node instead of it? So cluster head either drop the node, cluster head either use any backup node. So all those decisions are taken here. Some verification packet. Child node is also considered, say, in this topology. This is one hop, but after this one hop, there may be some nodes, backup nodes at the second hop or third hop. So some slots will be reserved for the child also. Okay, because this is going to transmit its packet to cluster head in his own slot. But for his child slots, he should have kept some slots reserved for himself as well as for his child. So that adjustment of slot or slot creation for the child has to do. Some trial packet execution is first performed. If trial packet get properly executed from source to destination, so it is assumed that the rest of the packets will flow accordingly and there will not be any retransmission chances, there will not be any packet drop chances. So trial packet execution is initiated and get the task list, create own schedule. Here node create its own schedule first, it give it to cluster head will remodify the schedule, create the modified processing schedule, and lastly the final schedule will be circulated. So based on the final schedule, rest of the nodes will act accordingly. But each node knows its own energy level, its own capability, and at how much time it can complete the task. So first schedule should come from node, and then in order to avoid the overlapping, the final modified schedule will be created by cluster head. So at cluster level, if you see, yes, it is central oriented. But after, because all cluster members should coordinate, should have to submit their result to cluster head. So at one point, we may think that this is not distributed, this is a central kind of architecture. But if you just go out of the cluster and if you see that cluster head communicating with another cluster head, that communicating with another cluster head. So now they are distributed. Within cluster, they are central architecture. After cluster, say, they are distributed kind of architecture. Some slots for control bits, some slots for transmission, some slots for processing, for receiving, and for, again, control bits. Some guard bands are used. to avoid the overlapping. But the main focus is how to design the processing slots. And when node 1 is processing, node 2 should be also busy in processing. Node 3 should be also busy in processing. Okay, so overlapping of processing slots allowed, but overlapping of transmission not allowed. When node 1 is processing, node 2 should not be in the mode of processing. It should be kept busy in transmission or something like that. So these are the next time slots. I have also processing slots for N1, N2, N3, N4. So here, I have given four colors, N1, N2, N3, N4, N1, N2, N3, N4. So this is a node where we have receiving slots, we have processing slot design and transmit slot design. When N1 is processing, after that N2 is going to process, after that N3 is going to process, or N4 is going to process. So what if we do like this? What I have done here is a simple figure like this. When 2 is processing, 3 is also processing, 4 is also processing. Okay, and once they complete their processing, they will submit their result to their cluster heads, and that too in their separate slots. So if these two nodes are not transmitting in the same slot, there are very less chances that they will collide or they will have some contention or some packet drop or packet loss. Routing structure is designed like this. I have a destination of square region, or I have to go to cluster head 1 or 2 or 3 or 4. I give it a symbolic name 0. Okay. So I can design my routing table like, if you want to go to 0, you have to visit SA. So SA is an intermediate node. To go to 0, 0 stands for all those, any one of those, if you want to go. So similarly here 0 and 1, 2 sets are designed. If you want to go to N1, you have to first go through SA.
How do you manage the power thing?
Power thing?
Power consumption and all. Let's say all the nodes you are telling that one is going to be in N4. So there should be constant or balanced power which is available to all the nodes. If one starts working, it stops somewhere. The second has to start work, all those things.
Some slots, as I said, we have the all the nodes have a clock, global clock or local clock. Everyone knows that as per written in schedule, they have to sleep or they have to remain idle or they have to transit or they have to receive or they have to process. Five modes are there. If I have designed that for 50 milliseconds I have to remain idle, or I have to remain, or I have to keep processing in while loop, let's say. I'm using while loop word because I am busy. So for 50 milliseconds I am busy. For 50 milliseconds I am busy, that time what other nodes are going to do is not a, I don't know. I'm node 1, I don't know what others are going to do at that time, because my slots are scheduled such that when I am processing, someone other is transmitting. When I am transmitting, no one is allowed. I don't need to do the carrier sensing. Who is transmitting? Is it a busy tone or not? Nothing like that. Because scheduler have scheduled me and my slots such that when I am doing X activity, other one is doing Y activity, some other one is doing Z activity. So there is no collision. Yeah, processing is allowed to be simultaneous. I can do, about the question, each node has some energy, initial energy. Now when it's working, its energy is getting consumed by some factor. Now it has some remaining energy. After completion of each task, it is providing its log to the cluster head. Next time the scheduler will schedule only those much amount of time for you based on the how much amount of energy we have remaining. And regarding the transmission power, so because here we are not adaptively or dynamically changing the transmission power of 18. The RF. transmission power is constant, the radius is constant. If it has a radius of say 40 meters, 40 meters for everyone. The fact is, we have to monitor only the energy, and there is a path head node designed for that, which log all the nodes. It is like a series of wire, it is like a series of lines. It is like a path. One path have 10 nodes, one path have a capability of next 1000 rounds of transmission and 1000 rounds of receive. Once 1000 round over, don't overuse it. Instead, use some other path or use some other backup nodes and do equal over balancing of node. So one node should not get over, one path
over is available to every node which is active.
Yeah.
Now, if one node becomes dead, then in that case, how do you have to cover
the node? We have backup list of nodes. We have list of backup nodes which are still not used or not overused. They have some remaining power. So if the log says, don't use N1 have this much amount of power which is below the threshold, don't use it. Scheduler will instead use a backup node, because on the same path one more backup node is available. Just we have to replace the entry of, let's say this one is died, 3. We will replace it by 31. 31 is just the entry for path scheduler. It's an entry for path scheduler, because it, I said all of them are in transmission range.
Automatically
controlled
that.
The decision is made based on the log only. Once the path transmission starts, the byte transmission start, after 50 rounds, I get one acknowledgement. That one acknowledgement contains info of node 1 to node n, how much they can survive in future cycles. They cannot survive, I get the figures. Based on figure, I get the, should I use this, should I drop this. If I want to some alternate node, do I have alternate node? Yes, I have. Replace the entry of N1, all the task of N1 will be now done by 31. And 31 will be responsible as the 3. 3 will be as it has dead, never it will be used. Once it give positive reading that okay, I have now enough power, let's say we recharge it and all that. Then only N1 will be treated as an active node, otherwise it will be treated as a dead node. So we have an active node, backup node and dead node collection available. And it is dynamically taken after every 50 rounds of transmission, because we assume that we don't need acknowledgement for each and every packet. Once I do the trial transmission, I know this path is secure, this path is capable of transmission, I am transmitting my bytes. I will not take care, after 50 rounds of transmission, I will take one acknowledgement. Is it okay? Yes. Okay, then we will design next transmission. Some log, as we have discussed just a minute before, I have kept the log that how and which node received packet, for how many time slot it will process, and at what time slot it will transmit. So this kind of representation can be easily done. We have a delimiter slash here. So N2 is a node, 2, 7, 9 are the slots. So these slots can be these slots, I mean, there are a lot of algorithms how to design slots. In my case, I use this kind of notation to design my, because I just focus on three slots: transmission, processing and receiving. So what advantages I got? I have searched a lot of papers. Can I find such a mechanism where parallel processing is getting used for multimedia traffic, let's say video multi-hopping. I use the word video multi-hopping. Parallel processing with video multi-hopping in WSN. Because WSN have a very limited capability of buffer, limited capability of processing power. But instead of using single node capacity and capability, if I add 10, 20 or 30 nodes, can I add their buffer? can I add their processing power and can I complete one task using all of them? So overlapping of simultaneous transmission is totally restricted, as I said, but transmission power processing is allowed. Due to broadcasting, node receives the packet at the same time, so the operation same time they set their clocks. Yes, broadcasting is allowed only at the coordinator level, because coordinator is going to set the clock for each and every cluster head available. If it do like peer-to-peer transmission, it may get, every node may get some different time. If it get broadcasted and within the same radius of, let's say, 40 meters, everyone would get, every node, every cluster head get the packet, and cluster head will also repeat the same thing with the cluster member, and every clock will be the synchronized. Some extra time slots are also provided after transmit fill in case some node do not respond it on time. Need is there for retransmission. Some guard bands, some control bands, control slots are designed just for the sake of retransmission if needed. I have used Raspberry Pi Python language for visually capturing the output, how the hardware behaves, because and I have used Zigbee also. So Zigbee module attached to Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi have a Raspi cam.
Why Zigbee is used
for communication? For transmitting byte, I have two Raspberry Pis, and how they communicate, I have two options: we use Wi-Fi module or use Zigbee module. Wi-Fi module again need a IP and all that. I was thinking about purely WSL. No need of setup architecture and setup infrastructure and all that.
It will be more secure, no?
Wi-Fi. Obviously, it is more, the data rate is also more. But my initial experiment, I have started with FFmpeg. Also, library also has some capability. If you give the IP address, it will directly broadcast, it will directly send the packet. So just for the experiment, I use both. I mean Wi-Fi as well as Zigbee. And Zigbee also always have a very low data rate and all that. And
scalability may be a problem if you use Zigbee.
Yeah, scalability is a problem. If you increase number of nodes, everything will get delayed and all that. But if we use Wi-Fi, obviously we have a good data rate. But these experiments, after that, I left the hardware there, and because I was trying to simulate it for 100 nodes, more than 100 nodes. So I used the simulator. I used the same configuration which Mika's had used in the hardware. Same configuration I set up for the node, and in NS2 I performed the same experiment, where interference, that was also my area where I was concentrating. Just with using two hardware, I cannot see interference there. So for NS2, that's why I choose NS2.
Come to the
conclusion
part.
Yep. So these are actually some results which I got from, this is the broadcasting 0 to minus 1. Then each of them reply to 0, 0 is a coordinate, a square agent actually. And the time it note, and the difference of time it note, and packet type, all that. And I will show you one case of multi-hopping here. Here multi-hopping is taken place where one send its packet to 6 and 6 send its packet to 5. And then 5 send its packet to 7. So here one hop neighbor and two hop neighbors, they can directly communicate, though they are not directly linked with cluster head, but they can communicate through the time slots. As the number of processing slots I have increased, I mean the relation between number of nodes, here number of nodes 5, then I increase it by some factor of 5, and the slots I was able to, because when you have a less number of nodes, we have more plenty number of slots available, then the slots have brought it down, and there is no need to give more slots. I have, this is a 5-phase reservation protocol, and this is seed exchange protocol. This is my protocol. I have compared how the throughput varies among these three, and number of hop versus end-to-end delay, it is also observed. And I have compared these two protocols. I have implemented actually FPRP mechanism and seed exchange within NS2. It's just two agents I have added, which can simulate FPRP and which can simulate SDX. So the conclusion is, we need slots for processing, transmission, and receiving. And whatever the contention occur, it occurs because of poor management of time slot. If we intelligently do the time slot management so that when one is working, other should be kept mute. Or when one is speaking, other should not speak. If both speak, obviously some problem will arise. If one speak and one keep on working, here we can manage the time slots and we can manage the all the three operations. Random waiting time does not help. Most of the protocols I have seen, they use random waiting time, random slot assignment and all that. If we want it parallelly, we should have a strict control over it. Ordering should be per priority of task. Some protocols are there which are mainly made for one kind of task only. If we want it for dynamically more number of tasks, so you should be able to design. But yes, programming is needed. Task 1 should take these steps, that program is needed. The future scope is what kind of media content you want to transmit, because I have used some files actually, because in NS2 we don't have a camera. In Raspberry Pi we have a camera. So we use some stack of image files, break or slices of each image file is done. Each slice is treated as an image for one node. So let's say I have 10 slices which belong to one image. I will distribute each slice to each node. I will assign it as a task. Each node will complete its task with its time, within its time. And finally, if T time is required, the task will get done in T by N time. So the future scope is media content can be separately saved, a separate buffer arrangement can be made, appropriate packet size.
Same thing for audio and video both.
Yeah, because we have a byte, obviously. If you consider video or if you consider audio, I have compressed both things.
But don't you think performance will be like compromised if you use the same thing for audio and video?
You don't?
If you use the same the technique for processing the video files as well as the audio.
We have plenty of nodes, we have a one cluster. I can assign one video task for say 5 nodes and audio task to 5 nodes. All of them are going to merge their result to one cluster.
But density of processing.
Every node is processing with its own speed.
But obviously video files are bulky files.
No, but when I capture one image, it is an image for me, it is not video for me. When I merge it, it becomes a video then.
What I am trying to understand is, obviously for the video you will require more number of nodes, right? For audio you will require less number of nodes. I am trying to understand this. For audio or video, do you require same number of nodes?
Yeah, I have a same program file for, I have same code file for there. One function is for audio compression, one function is for video compression. I assign audio compression task to set of 5 nodes. I assign video compression task to set of 5 nodes. All of them work with their own capacity, and within same time period, they all, I mean 5 from set 1 and 5 from set 2, merge their result at one place, that is a cluster head. Cluster head will merge. If we have a very fantastic tool, GDI or FFmpeg, if you give two streams, okay, let's say 25 frames, if you give, it will give you a clip along with merging of audio. So video clip formation along with merging of audio, and you will get a complete video clip, audio and video both. So if Raspberry Pi, if you allow me to show, I have some Raspberry Pi set, I don't have it now. But in most of the scenario, previous seminars, I have shown it, because I showed you that in three or four seminars, that how I do the Python, using Python, how I do that, audio and video merging, using FFmpeg. But FFmpeg is not my, it's a third party tool, so I don't really use it. I use a simple C++ programs which are available. Schedule distribution is very important, clock synchronization is important, slot designing is important. This is the confusion, and we can reduce contention, we can reduce the route discovery, we can reduce the maintenance and collision if we intelligently design the slots. Slots for three things: transmission, processing and receiving. These are my publications. Three international journals, two conferences, international conferences. And these are the references, around 80 references. And out of which, Ashutosh Bhatia, he has done a tremendous work in this. He is from IIT Kanpur, I think. And I like most of the papers. I have included more than 3 or 4 papers from Ashutosh Bhatia. He has done work in that. And these are some papers like self-organize, how they adaptively create their PDME schedules. So these kind of, though they are pretty old, I mean 2003, 2005, but that time also they were doing. And in 2016, 2017, I got some paper, but none of them work on the multimedia thing actually. Wireless is made just for transmitting temperature, pressure readings. I have used some different application instead of just video and instead of just pressure and temperature values. I want to use it in multimedia also, and that took using cooperative approach. That's it from my side.
I think one big comment will be, don't even these many slides. The slides which you are not reading, I think, not really encouraged to keep in your presentation. As per my experience goes, if you are presenting your thesis and the number of slides are going more than 45 or so, it actually distracts the interest of the people also. So you have, what I see is you have written a lot of things which is actually very general, which is either known to the expert or you can orally say, not required to be written here.
In some previous seminars, the comment was, I have done less literature reviews and all that. So this time I was ready with some these many protocols, and I was trying to explain them, but it was consuming a lot of time.
Why they said like this, but I have to see, even if they made a comment that the literature review is less, you can make a table. Have two slides only, which you name, you list this, so that it cannot be seen also. You understand my point? Nobody is going to read, but until you said the name of Asutosh, we never knew who is Asutosh. So many people will not be interested to read each and every thing, except they see that, okay, these many papers they have referred. So you can have it a very small font of 8 or 9, which is really not to be seen, and it fills only over of your slide. For people like that.
Some mechanisms are there, if you don't know these things, I mean, these things cannot be pasted in a chart. In chart, you can say yes, no, true, false kind of thing.
But try to be more of oral. I'll tell you what we get. Specifically, when I go for presentations to different agencies, as well as in IEEE, the papers which you are seeing, I will not be allowed to see my slides. Slides will be at my back, 5 minutes, 20 slides. And all the slides will be like 3/5 of the time. In these 30 seconds, automatically the slides will go off. So I cannot really see the slides at my back. There will be a television set which, if I refer also, some seconds will be lost. So I have to be very prepared that on this slide I need to speak only for these many minutes or these many seconds. So it makes your presentation very, very like easy going, stable. You have done a lot of work. But my comment is like, it is not very free flowing. It is not going into a flow. So you yourself have to judge that what you are preparing. We are going to speak to somebody. Is it going in a good flow or not? And like references, I have seen all the other people also. You are highlighting a lot of literature, survey and references. Like, the thing is, nobody has got time to read all those things. Have smallest font, if somebody touches you, okay. This is not to be seen. Like, just increase the font in front of them. It is convenient, not a problem. Because it fills your slides, but it is not giving you that time. Better to concentrate upon your own work. One more comment to others also who presented. I don't know how you start it. Do you really work so that your paper has to go to an international journal or an Elsevier or a Springer or something? Or do you concentrate upon your quality so that if you push it to any high-rated journal, it has to accept? I see the other way around. It may be because of UGC or any other body who have made it mandatory. But believe me, if you follow that, I have to write a paper so that it has to be pushed to Xavier and Web of Science or Thomson Reuters. I know what these journals are doing nowadays. I know some conferences, they ask you every sum and they will push your papers, even if it is not a good quality paper. And it is named as Xavier and all those things. So better to concentrate upon synchronizing your work, stabilizing your work, flowing your work. And after that, if you really push it to any high-rated journal, if it is not accepted, you will get excellent remarks or comments. So that you can work and automatically it will be pushed to that. So one is eligibility for your PhD, through international journals, this. But this is not going to help you in the long run, except getting your PhD. So if you really want to have a jumble of both work, plus the quality, I think whatever you work, presentation matters a lot, not PPT presentation only. Your thesis, PPT, your way of understanding the problems and all those things. Oh, I see some comments in the video chat from the previous reviewers also. Try to give attention to them as well.